China is bringing the nightmare surveillance state to life. The authoritarian regime of the Chinese Communist Party, led by dictator for life Xi Jinping, is crippling the freedom of its citizens and punishing people it perceives as a threat to the government's ideals. President Xi oversees this brutal, widespread oppression, the worst China has seen in decades. But unlike authoritarian states of the past, this regime has powerful digital surveillance and censorship capabilities at its disposal. The Chinese government depends on this repressive overreach of power to stay in control, to thwart brave dissidents who threaten or speak out against the government. That's why video surveillance, facial and voice recognition, GPS tracking, artificial intelligence, DNA, and smartphones have all been weaponized to monitor the Chinese people on a scale never before seen. And new evidence reveals the government is expanding its reach into residential buildings of ethnic minorities. Step out of line or criticize the government, and you'll likely disappear or end up in prison. Be unlucky enough to be in one of China's surveilled hotspots, like Xinjiang, and forced labor, sterilization, and abortion are very real outcomes. This worrying transformation threatens the freedom of all of China. And if left unchecked, the rest of the world could be next. In this special report, Sky News pulls back the red curtain to shine a light on the CCP's growing surveillance state, eerily reminiscent of 1984. Designed to bend citizens to their will and cynicize minorities, whether they're willing subjects or not. In China's public spaces, the government is watching. The country is home to 8 of the world's top 10 most surveilled cities. The exact number of cameras is expected to reach 626 million this year, according to research from Comparitech, meaning about one for every two of its 1.4 billion people. Now, Chinese activists who breached a government database have revealed a trove of information about worrying surveillance, dated from May to August, taking place in the Yuping-dong Autonomous Country. Chinese citizens might not know it yet, but the government is expanding its intrusive surveillance across the country, from public areas like streets and inside trains, into people's homes, threatening the privacy and freedom of an entire country. Data leaked about this new system, called the Tongren City Security Facial Recognition System for Building Controls, shows cameras have been installed in residential buildings that are home to members of the Tujia and Miao tribes, largely Christian people in China's southwest province of Guizhou, allowing the CCP to watch these ethnic minorities live.
The metadata and the tracking data attached to the facial recognition program includes the name of each citizen, along with their ID number, their license plate, and their mobile phone details.
Two cybersecurity analysts who worked with these activists say thousands are already under the government's watchful eye.
From the various clusters that we saw, there was about 4 different systems operating in this region. There was about 110,000 people under that had active profiles in the system. Every person that's in this database has been the victim of a breach of their privacy. Firstly, from the fact that this is now being used to regulate their private lives, but also because the Communist Party didn't actually put a password on the thing.
Frequently when you have to look into a camera, it will tell you, for instance, a specific angle that your face needs to be in to get the facial recognition for building entry or things like that. So they clearly know that they are being monitored. I think among the Chinese general population, it's just taken as a given that this is widespread and they're not necessarily happy about it, but it's accepted as a way of life.
The surveillance allows the CCP to swiftly respond to any movements they see as a threat, identifying individuals as either normal or abnormal by building up a meticulous profile constructed in the monitoring process.
This is surveillance that keeps track of people going in and out of apartment buildings, matches the faces to IDs, and mobile phone numbers, and identifies anomalies. So if you happen to be having unusual visitors to your apartment, then the state intelligence services know.
That could be followed by a swift visit from authorities.
What the Chinese activists are so concerned about is that people are in effect living in homes that have been turned into prisons. When someone's name pops up, it registers whether they are normal or abnormal. And if for whatever reason they're on a blacklist or an abnormal list, the authorities can immediately see where they are and turn up to find out what's going on or to arrest them.
Previous facial recognition databases that I've seen were involved in surveilling public spaces, particularly in areas where large groups might form to have protests. This is an extension of that same technology to control people's entry and exit to their homes. It also has direct application on the ability of the Chinese Communist Party to enforce norms in people's private spaces. So that previously, homes were seen as one of the few refuges for privacy in China. They are very commonly used for religious and folk services. They're commonly used for family gatherings. In this case, the Communist Party is explicitly monitoring things in a way that would make those sorts of activities much more difficult.
Cybersecurity experts are concerned the data obtained by the activists is a sign the CCP is expanding its surveillance systems used to monitor Tibetans, Uyghur Muslims, and other minorities that authorities use to track down dissidents, throw them in indoctrination camps, or force them to work in factories, subject them to sterilization, and other genocidal population control measures.
We're now starting to see technologies which had previously been deployed extensively in Xinjiang and Tibet now being deployed elsewhere within China and at a different scale. This is different to other facial recognition database systems that I've explored in the past. When I originally saw this one, I thought I was looking at something from an ATM camera, for example. But after we went through the metadata, it became clear that this was a building access management system where state government facial recognition systems were being used to authenticate people's access to their own homes.
This seems to imply that Beijing is essentially extending its Xinjiang-level crackdown and control to minorities, to religious groups, to basically anything that is a threat to the CCP. I think it's pretty much all religions that are not Chinese Buddhist, and it's I think fundamentally it's about individuals that they would deem that would be less than loyal to the Chinese Communist Party. So this is why we see minorities targeted, this is why we see Christians, Muslims, anyone that Beijing deems would not be loyal to the CCP or would potentially have an identity outside of that nationalistic hot racialism that Beijing is pushing.
This expansion from distant regions into central China could be a sign of what's to come for the future of every citizen in the country.
Now seeing it deployed more inside the central components of China is deeply concerning.
This is China rolling out the kind of surveillance they do over the Uyghurs in Xinjiang to other minorities across their country. And it's the future of what they'll be doing for every Chinese citizen.
The Chinese government has already crafted an Orwellian state with the widespread ability to gather private information about its citizens, using a terrifying network of cameras across the country, equipped with facial and voice recognition systems, along with a host of other surveillance tech, to find and track Uyghurs, Tibetans, and other minorities. In Xinjiang, China is waging an extraordinary crackdown using this high-tech surveillance to impose a digital police state on the region home to 10 million Turkic-speaking Muslims, a minority the government fears could be influenced by extremism.
In recent years, China has accelerated construction of a high-tech surveillance state. As you've heard today, that system has been used to monitor and suppress the freedoms of millions of Chinese citizens, most notably in Xinjiang.
Sheena said those not detained are subject to intrusive surveillance both in and outside China. The beating heart of Xinjiang surveillance is a system called the Integrated Joint Operations Platform. This platform works like a central nervous system connected to the region's surveillance, amassing tracking data about everyone in the area. In a 2019 annual report, the US Commission on International Religious Freedom, said Uyghur Muslims are constantly surveilled, their phones confiscated and scanned, their skin pricked for blood samples to collect their DNA, their children prohibited from attending mosque.
Technology plays a central role in accomplishing this mission. Millions of cameras recognize faces and license plates, while fingerprint scanners, Wi-Fi sniffers, electricity usage monitors installed in homes, and phone apps transmit information on citizen locations, activities, their speech, and more. But beyond data collection, technology provides another capacity that is critical to turning technology into coercive power, the capacity to integrate different sources of information. Surveillance platforms combine incoming data like this, the type I described, with existing information on citizens, their workplaces, their family members, their educational and employment background, biometric and medical data, their previous access or dependence on welfare benefits, and involvement in petitioning or protesting.
Sheena said while different pieces of the party state have collected such information in the past, China's locally fragmented governance made it hard to amalgamate and use it in a timely fashion. But today, technology platforms can quickly integrate these layers of information.
Authorities then use that integrated information to assess citizens' risk profiles and decide the best approach to prevent them from engaging in unrest or in dissident behavior. Although this system is not as omniscient as is sometimes portrayed, it is a high priority for China's leaders, and continued improvement and advancement of the system is likely.
According to a Human Rights Watch report, this surveillance system's tracking abilities are bolstered by an app used by an army of police and government officials to gather extraordinary information about individuals. As many as 1 million government officials have been sent to the region, with many living among Uyghur Muslim families, to report on any signs of extremist religious behaviour or suspicious acts, such as going through the back door. The Human Rights Watch said, the app provides three broad functions. It collects data, reports on suspicious activities or circumstances, and prompts investigative missions. When it finds someone or something the app considers suspicious, the app sends an alert to a nearby government official to find out more. The official is supposed to provide feedback and note whether the person requires further investigation. A Xinjiang Uyghur Muslim, called a Lim, described the region as having police checkpoints every 200 metres. He told the Human Rights Watch, they arbitrarily stop Uyghurs to check their IDs, and when that ID is input in an officer's phone, it tells them the story of their life. The Human Rights Watch said, in some cases, the app prompts officials to conduct a phone search for software, network tools, or content that's problematic. Do they have any suspicious software, such as WhatsApp? Have they visited websites that contain violent audiovisual content? Do they use any VPNs, encrypting data to prevent the authorities from intercepting and blocking it? Officials log the results of the phone search into the IJOP app. The system also restricts movement depending on the level of threat authorities perceive someone poses. The IJOP is connected to data doors installed at some of the region's ubiquitous checkpoints, which send warnings about problematic individuals. Together, the high-tech surveillance systems form invisible or virtual fences, an innovative system that allows the government to achieve pervasive social control in the region, while allowing mobility to those deemed safe by the authorities. The IJOP treats many lawful activities, like buying a SIM card or growing a beard, as signs of suspicious behaviour.
No authoritarian state has leveraged digital technologies more successfully than modern China. For religious groups targeted by the CCP, the result has been as devastating as it is tragic. As with authoritarians elsewhere, the CCP has long been able to repress public forms of religious organizations, religious practices, religious identities, and religious beliefs, especially in urban areas. But private forms of religiosity, including those practiced within one's home, have proven more difficult to monitor and repress. Digital technologies have changed that.
By 2017, moving to curtail expression of cultural, political, and religious diversity, President Xi ordered a quiet campaign of mass detention and forced assimilation in Xinjiang. Large numbers of people across the region began to disappear, and chatter about secretive detention camps swirled.
In part, as a result of the IGOP and related systems, an estimated 10% of China's Uyghur Muslims have been interned in the region's detention camps.
Chris said since regulations are often deliberately vague about which religious behaviours and practices qualify as extremist, authorities are able to find data points within information they've collected to justify internment.
Chinese officials have already used these techniques to detain individuals merely for texting verses of the Quran.
Former detainees describe appalling conditions, including extreme overcrowding, sleep and food deprivation, torture, forced labor, and most relevant to today's hearing, forced renunciation of religion, denial of prayer, and other religious services. Survivor and family member accounts conveyed through non-governmental and media organizations indicate that CCP uses discriminatory immigration policies targeting diasporic Uyghurs, Kazakhs, Kyrgyz, and others back to China for internment. There are also reports that some holders of Kazakhstani citizenship have been detained in Xinjiang while visiting family. The victims of these abuses all have one thing in common. They're members of a Muslim minority that has for centuries peacefully practiced its faith.
The Chinese Communist Party denied the existence of these detention camps until satellite imagery and first-hand evidence mounted in 2018, when it finally acknowledged them but as vocational training centres, justifying the region's controversial policies as part of the People's War on Terror. It's now clear these indoctrination camps are being used to make minorities loyal to the Chinese Communist Party, often as harsh, preemptive punishment for anyone the party thinks intends to violate the rules.
It is important to understand the CCP's strategic objectives in constructing this system. A key term used by China's leaders when they discuss these topics is fangkong, which translates to prevention and control. While Xi's predecessors preferred a doctrine known as stability maintenance, the current leadership has embraced a much more aggressively preventive version of social control, and Xi Jinping has spent much of the last few years overhauling the domestic security apparatus, its organizations, its personnel, its laws, etc., in order to pursue this vision.
China's surveillance technology has seeped into dozens of countries, setting up nations too focused on present dangers to become entrenched by CCP technology that funds further advancements of its oppressive designs.
China's surveillance technology is, in fact, already a global issue. My recent research, which I published with the Brookings Institution, shows that China has exported surveillance technology platforms to over 80 countries worldwide already, particularly those that are strategically important to China and those where violent crime creates an unmet demand for public safety solutions.
Experts say this is China rolling out the kind of draconian surveillance used in Xinjiang to the rest of the world.
Their companies work very closely with their government, and the export product they create brings that surveillance regime to places that they export it to. So safe cities projects backed by Chinese technology will have these kind of attributes.
Safe cities is a term used to describe metro areas with a range of advanced data processing and surveillance capabilities. They're part of a strategy formulated in 2015 to turn China into the world's top technology superpower by 2025. As part of the Digital Silk Road, this initiative aims to bolster the country's tech giants worldwide, construct China-centric digital infrastructure, and gain control over the global data supply chain. For some violence-plagued countries, this technology might come as a welcome boost to monitor their populations, but it's also a dangerous entanglement with a power that's already used that technology to oppress people at home. While the project could enhance digital connectivity in poor states, critics say it could also spread authoritarianism and increase dependence on Chinese loans. Huawei is one of China's companies peddling this idea. In an analysis of the company's wares, the Center for Strategic and International Studies said Huawei's safe city products have fueled concerns China is exporting authoritarianism. Options for safe cities include command centers, CCTV cameras, intelligent video surveillance, facial and license plate recognition technology, crowd monitoring, situational awareness technology, noise monitoring or detection, abandoned object detection, and social media monitoring. The center's analysis found Huawei's partners tend to be non-liberal, located in Asia or Africa, and middle income. Countries, it warns, could become dependent on China by adopting the safe city approach. It said, Huawei's growing foothold in these markets could pay big commercial and strategic dividends in the future. By 2050, nearly 70% of people in the world will live in urban areas, according to the UN, and 90% of global population growth is expected in Asia and Africa. After adopting Huawei's equipment, countries may be locked in by high replacement costs. As these economies grow, Huawei is poised to capture market share, spread its standards, and gain access to foreign data to improve its technology. Many Western countries have rejected Huawei's advances, including Australia. But these safe cities worryingly pose a risk to countries that have signed up to President Xi's ambitious Belt and Road Initiative. The initiative is a loans program where China lends extraordinary amounts of money to countries to invest in large infrastructure developments. Many of these countries will never be able to repay the communist nation, meaning China will have large debts it can leverage to make them adopt its safe city wares. China is also weaponizing the COVID-19 pandemic, an outbreak it neglected to stop spreading from inside Wuhan, to push its intrusive health tracking on other countries in which public health is tightly linked through technology to policing and coercive power.
As the pandemic has continued, the CCP has also begun to actively promote its surveillance technology as a public health solution, generating risks that COVID-19 will accelerate global reliance on Chinese surveillance technology. Surveillance technology is subject to very few global regulations. Where international standards exist, they have been written largely by Chinese technology companies.
Sheena said in a statement, if Chinese firms, bolstered by aid and propaganda from Beijing, can convince enough people their approach to health surveillance is best in class for coping with infectious disease, then COVID-19 will further accelerate existing global reliance on Chinese technology. Since late February, China has relied on health code apps to control reopening in the pandemic, putting China's enormous surveillance network to work. Wherever China sees a new local outbreak, health code checkpoints quickly follow. Sheena said, the party state intensified its already formidable surveillance apparatus, expanding both technology and human data collection efforts to include health-related indicators, placing citizens' movement under even closer scrutiny. Local public security authorities helped companies develop new health monitoring apps, which gathered data on individuals' body temperatures, their movements, and their social contacts. App developers, in turn, shared that data with police and authorities, who merged it with existing databases to facilitate lockdown enforcement. Most Chinese cities that have adopted the health apps have not promised to remove the data once the pandemic is over.
The coronavirus in Wuhan in late 2019 has accelerated the expansion and intensity of China's surveillance state, especially as it relates to public health, and that measures originally intended as crisis coping mechanisms now look to become permanent.
Philip Ritchie, Sky News.